Are we ready to start?
Yes.
Yeah, so thanks for having me. Within the next 1.5 days, we get a little bit into learning Karamba, structural analysis plugin for Grasshopper. And I thought I'd just give you a rough overview why we developed it in the first place. What was reasoning behind it, how we use it in our everyday purposes, and then definitely get into tutorials. I show you how to install Karamba and how to use it and how to make sense out of it, hopefully, and then apply it to your own work and further studies. So Karamba was developed by us, Bollinger Grumman engineers. We were fortunate enough, or are still fortunate enough, to work on a couple of really high-class buildings in the world. In total, we are now about 250 staff spread across the globe. Most of it is really in Europe, so that's in Frankfurt, where the seat of all of this is, where we founded the headquarters. There are about 100 people, and the rest is literally all over the world. These are the main offices. We have another office in Brussels, one in New York, and a little satellite office as well in China. Some of the projects that we have been working on, you know, when we started literally to explore more complex buildings and structures. One of the first projects was with Kurt Himmelblau, the BMW world. And basically the collaboration with Kurt Himmelblau since our first encounter of them is really driven also a lot of stuff that is now being implemented in Karamba, because their ideas of deconstructivism and really pushing the boundaries in terms of shapes sort of drove the necessity to come up with a tool that really allowed, you know, a little bit of flexibility in structural design and innovation. Yeah, we're working quite a lot with Sana as well. On the left hand side, that's a project with Dome A. The towers on the top, recently finished one of them at least, is Dominic Thoreau. Another project on the left-hand side, Kokimula, is also quite recently finished. Do all sorts of regular structural engineering jobs with stadiums, infrastructure. On the right-hand side, that's a whole new university that we've been involved in Russia. And then, yes, Hadid, all over the world. as well. In the US, another Kofunu Blau project, Mexico again, China, a lot of Kofunu Blau projects as well. This one is in Korea, the Busan Cinema Center, which I will show you a little bit later on in more detail. That holds currently the Guinness Book World Record of the longest cantilever in the world. It's over 80 meters long. And yeah, some other projects, Bissau Hadid, that was a pavilion for the Beijing Biennale in 2016. And some more or less local projects with an H architecture down in Melbourne doing some work on the Monash University extensions. We try to get on board with other overseas architects on some of the major competitions here. So this was for the Gold Coast Arts Precinct, teamed up with Peter Cook. Little stuff that we like to do with students to explore different ideas. So that's a grid shell that the students designed, analyzed in Karamba, reiterated the whole structure, and built it within 6 weeks. And I guess the real thing now is to show you a little bit more about the complexity of things and what we're into. So the original idea of Karamba was really that we faced a lot of issues with architectural designs and builders that didn't really want to build those designs, and engineers who thought they are not viable in terms of, you know, commercially or just really complex in building it. And we thought, you know, there might be a way to really sort those things out and maybe also just push the boundary in terms of engineering. So we addressed the idea of irregular structures and irregular structures, first and foremost, I guess, to, you know, irritate the eye so that people get aware of things that might be a bit of the unusual, and that those irregular structures can be as cost effective and optimized as any other structure that we usually see. So, and to come up with an idea, we obviously need a little project, and our project was to find a system which is irregular that performs as well as a regular truss. So that was our benchmark in terms of computation. And everything prior to that was really just, to the Karamba plugin, was just hard code, and there was no platform, let's say, for people to really interact with this tool. So it was really just hardcore coding and not really accessible to a broader range of people. And so there we started to look, obviously, at the main criteria of a truss. So a truss has moments and its diagonals and actual forces. And if it's really well-behaved structure, you end up with, you know, equalizing those forces in the system. To come up with something more irregular, there are different ways to create irregular structures, but we started from a more, let's say, random point of view, where we have just our boundary condition, and that is the surrounding outline of our truss, and that truss has basically more than two conditions, but two conditions that are obviously important for our structure. So we have one fixed joint, one fixed support, and then we have one sliding support. So it acts like a truss slash bridge. And then we have all these little red dots that are possible positions for any member that we throw into the system to connect to. So you start to generate a lot of lines that make no sense, basically. And the system started then to analyze those lines. So you get all your forces in those lines, And because it's irregular, it's already hard to grasp if you only look at the graphics to understand which elements are well performing, which elements are not so well performing. And the system then gave us the, for each member, the forces itself. And then if you add up everything here, obviously, you see that the one that is highlighted in red is out of your fitness criteria in terms of you want to be equalizing forces. So then there was the idea of, okay, let's optimize it with a generator that iterates through hundreds and thousands of different options, and those options will be benchmarked against each other, and then you start to take elements away in your generation that are not as good performing and place them somewhere where they hopefully perform better. You reiterate, and then you find a position eventually, or the system finds a position eventually for that member that has a good position overall. And to test this, we iterated it a very, very long time until we came up with this, which is not really irregular, sort of. But that showed us that the computation behind the idea works, because at the end of the day, you come up with a regular truss, which is the optimum solution. But if you tweak the generator and only look for certain criteria in your system, then you find an equally good system in terms of, for instance, the displacement under self-weight. The truss obviously here with 0.71 is a bit heavier, but it will perform better if you apply more and more load conditions and if you apply other boundary conditions than one below. But it shows that you can fine-tune it in terms of the self-weight, and if you look under only certain criteria. So it really depends on what you are looking for to optimize the system. That was one of the really big outcomes of that research, obviously. And then also it depends on the input that you give to that drives the optimization itself. And these kind of things started then to be implemented in a lot of our competitions that we worked with architects really early on together. So this is a structural solution for the roof, for Kopenhagen again in Frankfurt. That's an ice rink arena. And there the idea was we start with something, and then all these elements start again to randomly walk around to find its best position, to sort of optimize in terms of self-weight and the deflection only. And then you come up with something which is a bit more interesting maybe than the usual truss roof that you would have thought of. Obviously there are other criteria that we totally neglected at that stage, so for instance intersecting elements, really hard to connect. But this was not really the goal, it was really to showcase that you can achieve, I guess, from our point of view at least, more interesting outcomes with similar fitness criteria and performance ratings than with regular truss systems. So another competition that we tried to apply this in a slightly different manner was a information box for a big construction site in Vienna. And there the criteria was that we have the major grid of our information box, and only the red dots are possible locations for our foundation. So we couldn't really access all of the site due to a lot of civil works in the ground. And that means that our system has to look for optimum positions for the members so that we don't clash. This is how the scenario looked like. So we have just a regular grid. We have a certain amount and geometry of our support conditions, and then the elements sort of walked around until they find their position under our certain input criteria, and this was then the proposed outcome. So you can utilize these ideas quite easily nowadays with Karamba and Grasshopper, but back in the days, it was the stadium was 2006, this was 2008, Grasshopper didn't even exist. So that was stuff where we really only worked on the principal ideas and then started to implement all those kind of ideas. And the idea really developed then further into the plugin that you all know. None of you, I guess, have installed it yet because everyone was too scared to purchase it. But for students, it's still free. There are minimum limitations to it, but most of the tools you can still use. So I guess we just go through the scenario now to download and install Karamba together. So if you just go online to karamba3d.com, and that's anyway the best source if you want to dig deeper into Karamba. There you find heaps of examples, tutorials, real build projects and research projects. So you get a sense of, you know, what is achievable if you use the software to its advanced. So just go to Karamba 3D. Go to downloads, and there you see, you know, quite a simple instruction. Step one, get Karamba. So download it to your own, you know, system, whether it's 32 or 64 bit. And so you go through that step, and before you actually install it, there's one important thing that you need to know. Those are the features for every of those installations, because it's one installation file, and once you want to install it, it asks you what kind of version you want to install. And a lot of people install the trial version for whatever reason, but the trial version is really limited in terms of what you can do with Karamba, so you have to install the free version. And the free version gives you basically no limitations in terms of amount of elements that you're working with. Obviously, it's not a commercial license. We can't control you if you use it commercially, but like the Debian software package, it's not commercially. And then there are some limitations. So these elements here, these tools are called stitching and felting. This is excluded. You can still explore it with the trial version, but those are really advanced tools that you only should use anyway if you're really, really knowledgeable with Karamba and all the background knowledge that comes with engineering. Similar to, I mean, hinges at the endpoints of beams, sometimes it's helpful, but to really understand the structure and what's going on within the structure, you don't really need hinges, at least phase. You can have a look at hinges and how you can sort of still work with hinges, but not. There are some workarounds. Similar to, you know, vibrations and other things, frequencies that are more important, obviously, if you want to go into detail. When it comes to high-rise buildings or bridges, and then the section forces at arbitrary positions along the elements is also excluded, but it's also something really advanced. And also second order theory. I don't know how much you already know about theoretical structural computation, but there are more theories and they all align. So all what we do here is first order theory. That means we compute, we see the result of how it's behaving in terms of deflecting and internal stresses, and that's it. But if you want to analyze a structure more detailed, there's a second order and a third order That means that whenever you compute something and it's deforming, in the second order you take the deformation and put another load scenario on top of it and work with the already deformed object to really find out what's happening if something is deformed under constant light load. And if you put on another load, what happens then? For instance, if wind is a scenario that is then governing it. So there's more that actually needs to be considered for a structure, but in our case, we can just really work with the first order. And the cross optimization is also excluded, but there are also workarounds. So there's a special little plugin that we created for Karamba that optimizes cross sections, but there are other tools how you can optimize a cross section that we can explore later on as well. So if you downloaded it, installed the free version, then you should be ready to go. Another really handy thing to download is the Karamba manual, which you find under downloads as well. Somewhere really hidden, right here. So, you know, there are manuals in English, Japanese, think somewhere in the web you find it also in Chinese and for Spanish. And then for those of you who are really knowledgeable in terms of programming, you can download the Hacker Essentials, which gives you the ability to hardcore and manipulate Karamba in its core. So you can extract all the data and just use it for your own tools that you want to develop. So download the manual, and if you install Rhino, Karamba and Grasshopper, then you're basically ready to go. And what I would like to do is really just start with a basic example that you can find also in the manual. So to start with, we create a beam. Simple one spanning from point 1 to 2. And then analyze it and see how it works. And it's probably the best if you all go to examples of the Karamba 3D webpage. And there are heaps of examples, and all of them they are structured in terms of their difficulty and scenario. And so we will probably for today cover the simple examples and some of the moderate examples, depending on time and what you want to get out of the course as well. So if you have questions, please just interrupt me every time, ask questions, don't be shy. And then we can also discuss obviously your assigned work as well. But for now, yeah, if we just go to the simple beam scenario, it will first of all show you the outcome of the example. So you see that that is what we want to get out of it, basically just a cantilever that is deflecting, and it's showing you internal stresses in the color code. And then it will give you the already prepared Grasshopper script, and it will tell you what version it works, and there are some more advanced ones where they tell you that it's only working with a proper license and hardware is not working. So before you download all of it and you just want to try everything, keep in mind that some of them might not work then with the free version. So just click on it, download it. And open that file. It should look like this. If I'm too fast or too slow, again, just let me know. Okay. and you should see something like this. Yeah, everyone? No? Who's not seeing this? Hands up. You don't see it. What is unrecognizable?
Yes.
Okay, so while you guys get that sorted, probably just go through, you know, with some of the simple recurring tools in Karamba that you will use every time, no matter what. So one is the line to beam component. I guess you're familiar why you actually modeled, or you should have modeled, your bridges as single lines, as center lines. Do you know why we do this exercise, or why you did it? Yes, no? Okay, interactive working class. So usually the principle of structural analysis is really just to break it down in the most simplistic way to, first of all, speed up computation, but also only to find scenarios or results that are as, you know, simple as possible to understand as well, but also if it's really, really complex, then if you have a complex system, you just get more and more false results due to computations and the way how things are being analyzed. So all what we do is, if we have a beam that, you know, is sort of resting on two walls or whatever, this is free spanning. This would be more or less like a real-time scenario, and someone is walking up top. Then obviously we have, if we break it down into in structural elements, we have literally one support here, one support here, and everything that goes from those two supports represents the beam on top. Ideally, that is the center line, because then it's not out of centricity. So if it's something eccentric, then you deal with moments and stuff like that. It becomes tricky. So everything ideally is then placed in the center line. And then our person represents obviously our load. So we have, in that scenario, already have two load conditions. One is the dead load, or self-weight of things. And then obviously we have our live load, which is our person. And usually we deal with live load, means we deal with, due to security factors and other things, we deal usually with 1 kilonewton per point. And that is equal, roughly, 100 kilograms. Very simplistic and quite easy to understand. And then the dead load, or self-weight, of the beam depends, obviously, on the material, of the mass and density of the material. So this could be anything. But these are the two load conditions that we're working with. And then we have, from a structural point of view, also conditions of how this support is, or how that beam is being fixed. So we usually have a scenario where we have one fixed support and we have something that can move in multiple directions, or maybe only one direction. And for those supports, there are 6 degrees of freedoms, basically, because we're working in our critique system. And so we can have, if you look at our Cartesian coordinate system that we are just moving around in space, we have obviously x, y, and z. So these are the three main directions that we can control of a support. And then we have, again, three other degrees of freedom, which are the rotational degrees around the axis. So that sums up in, you know, 6 degrees of freedom. And we can control all of those 6 degrees to create our supports. Mimic hinges, sliders, and any other things that are necessary for our structure. So this is basically the scenario that we want to create now in Karamba. And the line to beam represents our center lines of our structural elements. So for us to work in Karamba, obviously we need to translate a pure geometry-driven design into a design that deals with real-world scenario, so with real physics. That means all of those components that come in Karamba translates the geometry into things that are necessary to compute. So line to beam means that that line becomes a structural member. Then we have here our supports, and these are the conditions of the supports. Those conditions are the 6 degrees of freedom. So this will give us the opportunity to play with those supports. And then obviously we need to apply some loads. Gravity is usually a load that is pre-programmed, so you don't have to add gravity as an extra load. And then you can just select different types of loads, even though there is gravity available. You have point load, line load, and then mesh loads. And then you apply cross sections and materials to build up your scenario. And then collect all the information in our little assembly model. And this is basically our structural model, and then from there on you can just extract a lot of data, analyze it, and then visualize the results. To get here, it's really just, you know, you create 2 points in space, you draw a line in Grasshopper between the 2 points. So it's less parametric at that stage, obviously, because you don't have any sliders involved. So the line to beam component in the Grasshopper canvas here, most of that stuff that you're working with can be found here under the section called model, to just build up your model. And there's the one component called line to beam. So you can call that up. That's literally the one here. And Karamba is designed that way that you can usually start from scratch quite easily and understand your inputs and understand your outputs. So Karamba asks that for lines, endpoints, but usually lines are totally fine to be identified. So then as an outcome, you have some information available. So every component in Karamba, or every element in Karamba, can only be in your system once. If you have duplicate elements, then the system is not really understanding your structure and knowing which element should be belong to the structural design, and therefore can't really finish the computation. And as a result, Karamba comes with inbuilt remove duplicate points and lines, so you don't, you know, need to use those utilities, which are also coming not in this version, but they were available as an extra module as well. Well, it's still there. Remove duplicate lines, remove duplicate points, isn't there anymore, but it's all inbuilt, so you don't really need to rely on it. And here in the information you just get it, but you know, number of duplicates will remove zero because it's only one line. And then you get that there's a certain distance involved in for that line, depending on if you're working in millimeters or meters. There might be some effect that's still a bit buggy sometimes. I personally prefer to work in meters, but it shouldn't affect your outcome of the result. So just, you know, drag down the line to be component from the model section. And there you find also the support tool, which looks like this. And to define support, you only need points. And the points obviously need to be points that are within your system. So those two points at one point in that case. It was being used to create a line, it's also at the same time being used as a support. In that case, because it's cantilevering, we fix all 6 degrees of freedom for that point, so that it becomes a rigid connection. And you can see this in your model here. Whenever you see all the symbols, like the three little arrows, these are the transverse degrees, so in X, Y, and Z axis. And if you see them, you know that you locked those three directions. And around every arrow, you see a purplish circle. And this just highlights that the rotation around that axis is also locked. And here, obviously, all the inputs are also being locked. You can see that by the little black dot. If we just remove one of those, you can see that the circle also disappears and you unlock the rotation. And depending on the scenario that you're working with, you already see that you have quite a big difference in the result if you play around with the support condition. So to start with every Karamba model, I would suggest to fix all of the points in your supports first, so you get a result, and then sort of work backwards, that once you have decided what kind of scenario you're dealing with and what kind of supports you really need, then you can play with the design of the support, rather than just throwing, you know, 6-7 different supports and none of them as a whole work together. Because if you're unexperienced and you just do something, then you get just weird results. So start with a really fail-safe scenario, which is fixing everything, and then work your way back. So then we have our lines, we have our supports, and then obviously it becomes, you know, defining an additional load, which at that point we just placed at the end of our cantilever. And the loads have a separate little section up there in the canvas, and usually looks like this. And whenever you pick a certain kind of input load, the whole interface changes. because some of those loads, they require different inputs. Most of the time, point loads are loads that you can mimic basically all load conditions quite easily. So we work there with the loads. The type of load is point. We put as input, that's the position basically, or IND, our point at, from the end of the line. And then we can apply any slider, and that slider represents the force. And in that case, the force is kilonewtons. So here we have 7.3 kilonewtons, which would mean 730 kilograms. And because we're working or we're mimicking real world scenarios, most of our force is pointing downwards. In every modeling environment, we have our Z axis upwards. So whenever you apply a force, just remember that force needs to be negative to really simulate that force that acts upon our structural system. And a force is nothing else as a number and a vector. And the number is representing the length of the vector, or the direction, or both of it. And this is then your force. So vectors equal forces. And then, to even make it more realistic, obviously we want to apply a cross-section. When you start from scratch and you just have your line work, Karamba already applies one cross-section and one material, so that you can start from scratch. And the cross-section is a circular 250 steel tube, basically. And material is just preset steel. Just to keep you going and play with your scenarios, and then you can, again, similar to the supports, can work backwards and find the elements that you really need. So to select the cross section, again, there's a separate section in Karamba that allows you to play and deal with cross sections in a lot of different ways. But here we only want to assign a cross section, so we go to the cross section area, and this is usually how you would start. So you have, similar to your points input, you have a cross-section input. And cross-sections can be obviously manipulated in a lot of ways. One thing that you can't do in Karamba is, or you can, but it's more difficult. You can only work with symmetric cross-sections, like you usually do as well with timber and steel. Because they are just standard products off the shelf, and you use them obviously and utilize them because it's not only easier but also more efficient. So whenever you apply a cross section, whether it's rectangular, circle, I-beam, whatever, it is literally just mirrored around the central axis. And therefore, you can only have control over a certain amount of input data for the cross section. So for instance, for all of our I-beams, we can control the upper width, lower width, and the thicknesses of the material. And then we have, again, box cross sections. We have slightly different inputs. Circular hollow sections, again, depending on the cross section itself, we can change things. And then there is a cross section scenario called shell, which is for surface models, because sometimes our line models or stick models are not efficient enough anymore to represent, for instance, behaviors of slabs and big walls, and therefore the component that calls its name. Shell is the most efficient one, and that's basically if we have a wall. That's basically the center surface. Yeah. And that is representing then our wall. And therefore we can only manipulate the thickness or height of the element. And then we have a trapezoid, which is a bit more flexible, but it's a solid. So all the other cross sections, they are either hollow or just extruded elements, and the trapezoid element here is a solid, so you can use this, for instance, for simulating timber products quite easily, because it's solid. And here you can manipulate these three sides, basically. So it's the upper width, lower width, and height. This is when you really start from scratch and want to experiment different cross sections, play with them. Probably more easier way to start with, I guess, is Karamba comes with an inbuilt cross section library. Unfortunately, Australian products have not been included yet, so we're still working on it. But you can read a lot of cross sections from other countries into your scenario. And basically, with this tool, the cross section selector, that's this tool, and the cross section library, which you can read. So the range selector gives you the selection of, like I said, different countries as input. So you can, you know, just limit the cross sections to standard European mainland profiles, and you can get all of them from the UK, US, Russia, Japan, India, Canada, and Germany. And as I mentioned, Australia is excluded yet, but will come soon. And then you can, obviously, because you have there the choice of over 6,600 different cross sections, which is quite a lot, you can then start to limit your selection with the cross-section selector by just inputting your whole cross-section library, and then, for instance, say I want to have only cross-sections with a maximum height of 400. And the maximum width of 250. And then you you start to limit then your selection. And then you can even limit it further through other means. Selecting the ID basically of the cross section within that list, and then at the end you come up with, you know, different cross sections based on your selection criteria. And that is a good way to apply a certain type of cross section. And then obviously you can still regulate it by a certain type of family and a shape. This is the usual way how you can select cross sections also in any other more, let's say, advanced structural analysis software. And then you can also start to define materials with also a preset defined material selection, which you find here in the material section. And they are again similar to your cross sections. There's a family, either steel, concrete, wood, aluminum. And these are just the four most common materials used in construction industry, except of masonry, that you can work with. And then, depending on the family, there are different subcategories in terms of their strength that you can choose from. So we could just go into concrete and pick any one of these. And obviously, the higher the number you go, the better the material is performing in terms of capabilities of withstanding forces, but also it becomes more heavier due to the density of the material. So in that case now, we define just steel. And if this is previewed, then you basically don't see a lot in the assembler model. So you only see that one line, and you see 2 points, and you see 1 point. That is basically the center of gravity of your model. And then to probably visually inspect it, if you know everything is correctly set up, there's a tool that's called Model View, and you find this here in the results section up here. That's called Model View, and you can just plug in the model into the model, and that shows you the structural system. So you see again the restraint support, and you see at the end our load. And then you can play with the scaling of things. At the moment it doesn't change anything because it's only the scaling of the sphere of deformation. In that stage it hasn't been analyzed yet, so you only see the representation of the structural system. You can visually inspect the local axis of every element. So that's the green arrow here. That's sometimes really handy if you have freeform elements and you want to apply obviously cross sections, and the cross sections should follow your underlying double surface, double curved surface, for instance. Then if you know the orientation of each element, you can start to orient then the cross section profile towards the perpendicular of the surface, for instance. And then you have just things where you can sort of manipulate render settings, and the render settings is really just a representation of the actual cross section, which comes later. You have the option of highlighting all sorts of different information that is already inbuilt in the structural system. So you could highlight the node tags, which is basically quite handy if it's a really complex system and you sometimes don't really follow the logic of a good structured grasshopper script. And then you want to know where's your first point, where's the second point, so you can just highlight it with the node tags. You can highlight obviously the element tags, so every element will be numbered. You get the element identifier, the cross-section name. So there's a bit of inbuilt, I guess, built logic already. You get the materials that are assigned to the cross-sections. you can highlight the load values. So, you know, if, for instance, you're just way in your script manipulating certain things, you forget about, you know, the loads that you apply to, you can see the value there as well. And then there's this little section here called load case section. And this has something to do with the first order and second order and different load scenarios. So whenever you apply a load, it all gets fed into load case zero, which means if we have that little scenario here, in load case zero we have the load case of gravity, the self-weight, and the life load all together, and we get the results of all those loads acting on our system all together in one point. Most of the time, we're dealing with different load case scenarios. That means that we only want to analyze a structure without any additional loads, just to see if the principles of our structure is correct. Because if it's not holding up itself, there's no point applying life loads to it. So that's load case scenario usually number one, or in that case zero, is only under gravity load. Then we had another load case, which is then only the point load. And then we only see the reactions of that point load applied to the system without any additional loads. And then we can apply on another load case scenario, for instance, wind, we can apply dynamics, we can apply all sorts of different things, and can study carefully the reaction in the system of every load case, and then we can start to combine the load cases. And then this will give us a holistic picture of our structure in the end. So you see that there's a lot of stuff that you need to know, and you know how to set it up correctly, but once it's done, you can start to analyze it. And there are different algorithms available. So in your free version, probably the selection of algorithms will be limited, so you won't see the large deformation analysis, which is being used as a form finding tool. Basically, it's nothing else as a upside down hanging chain model. So all of you, I guess, are familiar with hanging chains, but it's basically that scenario. Again, we have our first system, we apply a load, that load deforms, and then once we flip it up, we have sort of an optimum scenario for the forces in here. So this can be simulated with a large deformation tool. Then we have buckling modes, eigenmodes, and natural vibrations, which are really detailed analysis for things like the bridge, if it behaves under, you know, how it behaves under a natural vibration, and also for high-rise buildings, because you want to know not only if it's structurally sound, but also if you can use that system from a usability point of view. So for instance, if a high-rise building has a high frequency, and you know, it just is acting like a pendulum, moving in both directions really a lot, people just get sick of the high-rise building and they won't use it. Similar to bridges, the dynamics of a bridge, I guess all of you are familiar with the video of some hanging bridges, and they just sway a lot, and then just due to the dynamics it will crash, will be destroyed. That's stuff that you can analyze with those three types. And then other algorithms that are available if you have a more advanced version is, again, the optimization of cross-sections. So that is one of those inbuilt optimization tools that allows you to give a system a certain range of cross-sections, and the system is just picking the best cross-section for that scenario that you design for. And then there are other, I guess, design tools. They are called BISO means bidirectional devolutionary structural optimization, which is sort of the principle behind the first scenario that I showed you, where we have an irregular structure. You take elements away, analyze it again, place it somewhere else, analyze it again, until you find a good outcome. So BISO is the inbuilt solver for this kind of strategy. One is inbuilt for beams and one is for shells. And then you get a hybrid of all of the above, which is a tension compression eliminator. The name says it all, so you can just apply it, take away all the tension elements, and you see how it works, or all the compression elements, and see if you can achieve only tension-based system. So once you apply the first mode of algorithms, which is the first order of theory one analysis, you won't see anything. It's just being computed in the background. But there's already some information available, obviously. So you get the maximum displacement. And the displacement is in meters. And that's why I prefer to work in meters in Karamba as well, because all the pre-setups for the computation are in meters. So you don't really need to look at it and just swap it into the numbers that it's really representing. So at the moment here, 0.05 meters, which obviously are then 5 centimeters. You get the gravity in terms of the resulting gravity, if there is a resulting force. You get information about the elastic energy of the element, which is good to know for some occasions. And so with this you only get basically the displacement as a result, which is for a first round of more investigative design for your structure quite good, because you want to limit the displacement, but you want to see more results which are already computed in the background. And therefore there's another handy little tool that is called beam view. And model view, which I already showed you at the beginning, but if you plug this in now after you compute it, you see already the deformation. So before we couldn't see the deformation because it wasn't computed, and now obviously after the computation was running, we see already the displacement. The displacement that you see here is not the true displacement, as long as your scale in the display is obviously exaggerated. So this is 50 times the real displacement or deformation. So if you put this back to 1, then you see the real deformation. Now, because it's computed, you can also visualize the reaction forces that are in your model, which are basically all the forces that are acting on the support. And because every static system needs to be an equal system, it's in equilibrium, we apply 7.3 kilonewtons as a force that acts on our system. As a resulting force, it also should have the 7.3 kilonewtons. If you don't have the 7.3 kilonewtons, then obviously it's not 100% in equilibrium and something in your design is wrong. And then we have our moment forces, and they are just simply resulting from the case that this is a cantilever, just gets pulled down, and the rotation around our y-axis obviously is happening. We restrain it, therefore we have our reaction forces around that axis. If we now plug in our model view into the beam view, we get more detailed results of the beam itself. So you should see at the beginning just that blue outline, and that only is a representation of the cross section itself. And you can have a control over how it's, you know, how detailed it is represented by that little slider here. Usually one is way more than enough. It's just a really rough mesh that identifies and shows you usually the cross section that you want. And then you can start to visualize the main two drivers of our structure that we want to know to redefine our system. One is the displacement that is color coded, in that case going from white to a dark purple. White means there's no deformation, or the least amount of deformation. And the dark purple one, obviously the darker it gets, the more deformation we have in our system. And then we have utilization. And the utilization is really the internal stress of the material and how much of the material we utilize. And we have, again, a color code, and this is a color code with three colors. We have blue, we have red, and then we have white. In that case, blue is for tension and red is for compression. Blue, you know, you can just imagine it's steel, it's the best material for tension, therefore blue, and red, it stands for bricks, let's say, because bricks are good for compression. So we know what kind of utilization we have in our system. Wherever we have white, there is again the least amount or no utilization at all. This is only a color-coded representation. We can now also visually show, if we go a bit more into detail of the beam view, in that area here, we can showcase the section forces. So if you go into Filled and click on MY, this is the section forces in the member around the y-axis. And this is the graphic representation of it, and obviously with that number attached to it, you know that this is sort of the magnitude that we're dealing with. You won't see anything around MX because around the axis there's nothing happening. Similar with the z-axis. And then you have normal forces in your beam itself. And in that scenario, again, you only see certain forces because there are only certain forces available due to the setup of the system. And here you only see normal forces in the z direction, because we only apply the force in that direction. And then we can visualize axial stresses in a simple system. The stresses are usually equal to the utilization. So this is only the color code. It doesn't really give us an indication of the real performance. Real performance only be measured by numbers, and we can call up the numbers if we connect a legend. That is an inbuilt plugin or tool that comes in Grasshopper. And then it gives you more detailed information and in combination with this detailed information and the color code that you already see here visually, you see now that the system can deliver under that applied load, is utilized at the highest point of about 50% in both directions, so in compression and a little bit less in tension. And similar is then for the displacement. So if you just swap, you see the resulting displacements here now in centimeters. And this will give you then a better understanding of what is actually going on in your system. And with these numbers and the color codes, you can then start to really understand the structural solution that you're working with and how to manipulate and refine it to make it better. And in the Karamba manual, there is a good section about a little bit of the input that you need to deal with every day. So basic information about properties of materials to pick the right material for you guys. About the theory of, you know, strains, stress and stiffness and how additional loads affect your structure. And one of the, I guess, most important things is really that section A3, tips for designing statically feasible structures. And it really talks about, first of all, a little introduction of how to analyze structures and what a structure is. But in here, that little section, that is quite important, that gives you the amount or the number that you have to work towards if you want to have a feasible structure in terms of maximum deflection of the system. And it says that as a rule of thumb, try to limit your structure to, you know, L divided by 300 if it's a single spanning structure, so all of our beams. That means that length divided by 300, that's the maximum displacement. And if you have a cantilever, that is about the length divided by 150, that's the maximum deflection that you should work towards too. This is just really principle, basic rule of thumb. Obviously, it comes with way more information if you go into more detail, but this is to be on the safe side. And then in terms of utilization, you want to be below around about 80% to be in a safe zone where your structural elements under too much stress so that they fail. Because Karamba is not showing you that the system is failing, it's showing you the maximum theoretical deformation and utilization, and it's up to you to decide if that system is failing or not, based on the rules of thumb. And in terms of the slenderness, which means that the cross-section that you want to apply to should be also within a limit. Otherwise, you just add up a lot of self-weight, and there's a threshold where your self-weight, because you want to limit the deflection of it, you just add up, you know, bigger cross-sections to limit the deflection, but then you're adding a lot of more self-weight, and at some point, it's a tipping point where the gravity and the self-weight of the system is way higher than your applied load and the system fails again. So therefore, the slenderness of compressed elements is in a good ratio of 1 to 100. So that means if you span 10 meters, you need roughly about 10 centimeters of element that is compressed in height. So a 10 centimeter slab can perform your 10 meters span. Only, you know, if you're looking at the ratio and if it's a compressed element only, and then obviously this will be added up to your other two rules of thumb, and then you can have really good judgment about your system if this is a good structural solution or not. So I guess that's the first round of information for you. Any questions so far?
You said that the software takes into account the rabbit load.
Yep.
So what if you want to analyze the structure without taking account the own weight of the bit? You have to put a rabbit load like in the opposite direction?
Well, I would ask why you want to do this in the first place.
Okay.
Because, yeah.
For example, when you said that you have to decide a cross section to start analyzing.
Yes.
So do you have any which method do you use to select the first cross section to use it and then make the analysis?
That's probably based on obviously experience.
Okay.
But most of the time I would just start with a preset cross section that also comes in Karamba with a circular tube.
So you pick like a small cross section?
Yeah, it's really a small cross section, and then you start from there and you can see which one are failing, and then you apply obviously other cross sections to the ones that are failing. But a lot of cases, obviously, it also comes down to practicality, how you want to connect those elements. You know, tubular section obviously has a totally different way of connecting it, usually as a rectangular cross section. There are different types of dealing with this, and I guess there's no right or wrong to start with, but really to begin with, I would just use the smallest cross section and then just go from there in an iterative process.
But there's no process before to say, okay, approximately I know that I'm going to need this kind of cross section.
Yeah, you can also apply a cross section from the beginning that you feel comfortable with, and then see how it works out. Other questions? So that was all clear for you? So I guess we can go into a little bit more moderate territory now. And this is basically the workaround to show you how to optimize cross-sections without the cross-section optimizer that usually comes with a more advanced license. So if you just download again that script here. Everyone seeing similar or the same outcome? Okay.
No response means yes.
So this is the way how to optimize cross sections without the inbuilt Karamba cross section library and tools. It's a bit of a hackathon. So first, you can start with any geometry, obviously. In that case, this is just a grid-like structure. And the grid is really based on one origin point. That's the one here. And in that case, just utilizes standard inbuilt tools that you can find in the vector and the grid, and then you create a square grid or whatever grid you want to have. And obviously with this grid of points, we can then build up our line work. So in here we have rectangles, they're all closed. We need to break them up so that there are single lines. Therefore, we have our explode component in between. And here you start now to see that every time we get input into Karamba, we have to make sure that all the branch logic is flattened so that everything is within one single outcome. If we have branches, Karamba starts to analyze each branch, and therefore you get a lot of different outcomes and you never find the right solution. And your computer might crash because there are too many solutions. So therefore make sure everything is being flattened as input. Every time you create a branch, chop it off again. In here, just because it's a bit of an older version, we still have the remove duplicate lines. You don't need it, but you can just, you know, to make sure that all of the double lines are really gone, place that element again, and then use our first convert line to beam component to build up our structural logic. And then there's a bit of stuff happening here, which is just really to, I guess, showcase why you can do this and how you can apply the ideas of optimizing cross-sections. So all those three multi-directional sliders and the little setup here will really only give you the selection of different score positions. So whenever I move the slider here, that's one support, depending on your power of the computer that you're dealing with. It's either in real time or it's a bit slow. And you see that wherever I place a support, around that support, we're obviously attracting a lot of forces in the system, therefore the cross-sections closer to the support become higher due to the moments. So however you control the supports, is the location of the supports is entirely up to you, obviously. And then you define your supports. In that case, those are all pins, these supports, so they are obviously supporting your structure in X, Y, and Z, but on top, all the moments are free, released, so that means that we have the pin connection on top. And the cross sections are free to rotate around those three axes. So this is our basic build up scenario again. So we have the lines, we have our supports, and then apply loads, in that case on gravity. Then again, we can check if our structural system is any good, and see if all of our information is embedded. So we have all our line work, we have our three supports, freedom around the rotational axis, and then we can start to analyze it again. We can see the results with our beam view, And here in that scenario, obviously we can, similar to the other scenario, we can see the displacement as a graphic representation, so we have a lot of displacement here due to the fact that there is no support. Similar to the utilization, we have a lot of tension in these two areas here. We have a lot of compression in that zone. So we can understand already a little bit the behavior of this structure. And now we want to optimize the system. So the system at the moment only deals with pipes. That's the pre-setup, the circular hollow cross-section, and also the pre-setup in terms of materials, which is just steel. And now we want to replace those cross-sections, for instance, with elements that represent the moment forces. So, because it's just a simple structure where we apply forces in the vertical area, we can have a look at the moments around the y-axis, bending moment about the local axis, and then visualize this. And then we can fill it, and we already see all those spikes, and those spikes basically are the highest moments, and those will give us then the right height to apply to our new cross section in both directions, positive and negative. And whenever you visualize one of those moments or normal forces, the section forces itself, you get those forces as output, and you can manipulate again those curves for anything really. And here we use then those curves to create our new cross sections. So we analyze the curves, evaluate it, and get the highest point or the points of the curves itself. So that's the point and curve. And then from that point, that's the maximum, the extreme. We obviously also need the low point to create our structure, which is then the original grid setup. So that comes from our removed duplicate lines output, because we still want to have single lines so that those single lines match the position of every single line for the section forces. And then once you start now to for instance pull your points from the section forces to your geometry that pulls, you create a vector, so the direction of it, and from that vector you create then again directions, and those will create then your surfaces that represents the maximum section forces in itself. So from the vectors that we create, not to just go into detail here, we only need obviously the z component of the vector, and then just to make sure that really we get the maximum and the minimum, everything beyond or below zero. So therefore, this is just really a number to cross-check that you get the right numbers itself. And this is then the maximum and the minimum moving for the geometries, for the points. And line edges. So all you need at the end is this. You need the upper line and the lower line. And then you can create your rectangular cross section. And this has obviously nothing to do anymore with Karamba. This is only a visual representation, and you can't, well, you can then start to reanalyze those elements, but because those elements are surfaces, then you have to translate it into shell components or go back and find then the center lines of those and remodel the whole thing. But there's the possibility to take your analyzed models apart and take only several elements from your analysis and from your structure and rebuild from the results that you got there a new structural solution. And then you can start to compare or even reiterate between two different versions. But with this setup, at least for the final state of your design, you can drive sort of close to a real optimization of cross sections once everything is finished. You got any questions? Very good. So I guess before we go into more detail, maybe we can just talk about your stuff and what you think, how you know Karamba can help you and what to do with it, or even how you would get started. Now it's the time that you talk. Take one of your examples, yeah. Maybe up to the front, and then see what we can do with it.
Who's game?
Katie?
No.
No, you're not game enough? Why not?
I don't.
You don't know? Okay. Any volunteers? No volunteers. How did we get your assignment done for you in class? Steven?
I don't know what I'm doing.
So
are you talking about the old bridge, like our old ones?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have the modern dome?
I have the same bridge, Katie.
Yeah, but Katie doesn't want to stand up.
Well, if it's the bridge, then that's fine.
Yeah, do you want to?
Yeah.
It's not cool enough.
Yeah.
So what? It doesn't matter. That's not the point.
The design doesn't matter at all. It's really about to understand the principles of how you apply Karamba.
Yeah. Do you feel as if you could do that without having an example? Anyone?
I mean, you can already start, and we'll just walk around and help you while you go.
Yeah, no, okay. Heidi's gonna. Does it will it plug into that system?
I think so.
It is an Apple.
Ow.
No, I'm just saying they like ignore most common like video.
Really?
Yeah. Like, does it have HDMI?
You got HDMI
in
it? Yeah, is that it?
Yeah.
fruit jump apple.
To the center line part of the model.
The center line?
Yeah.
Like the middle of the bridge?
The center,
the
you know, the center line struck like the thing, the lines that define this, you know, the skeleton.
Yes, like.
So if you hide everything but those lines in Grasshopper. Just maximize perspective and just zoom in.
It's literally just me.
did you do the exercise in making it like single lines? Like center lines?
What, last week?
Yeah, and the week before?
No, the week before. Yeah, I think so. Maybe not.
Okay, so we've got two lines.
Just for
the all right. So you weren't using center lines? Should someone else be happy? Alright. I'm happy to stand.
Happy to stand. Hey, Franco. Franco, have you made a center line model of your bridge?
I did, but it's a good example. I was trying to play with this in our room.
You saved it, right?
Yeah, sort of, what I say, you know, that's what I'm trying to think about.
Could you bring it up? Could you bring it up? I might have to fix it.
Wait, no. Can you try someone else's? Let me get my arrow
bridge. Do you mind? I have to head up in about half an hour. So.
Yeah. So I was right in thinking that not everyone had it done.
Just have like a line of
trouble.
I know,
that's good.
So it's like a
You know, like the
shell on it?
No.
Is it
kind of just like a cross section thing as well?
You guys had like horizontal bars going across?
Yeah. We didn't have any vertical members.
You didn't have any vertical members?
No, it was just the trusses. Like,
okay. Well, that's a little bit wide efficiency to put in there.
Thank you.
take another flip.
Okay, do you want to get rid of the properties tab? We don't need it. Yeah. You don't need your computer. I'm just using that one.
I can't do anything. I mean, I can, but...
I don't understand why you guys think that you can't do it.
No, I can. What do you need to do? I don't know.
We're gonna analyze this bridge,
okay.
and Sasha and all of us will talk through it. But it's like, it's kind of, in a way, it's proving that it's not rocket science. It's just structural engineering, right?
Yeah. I'm an engineer.
Yeah, definitely. Everyone's an engineer.
Okay.
So what is that?
Is like, how is this online? Is this now?
No, these are centers of beams, right? So there would be a beam that fleshes that out.
So there's no solid or whatsoever, it's just
right.
The line work.
It's not, we're not looking at like a tube. We're looking at lines that describe thin linear elements, but beams.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're just probably going to make them out of steel instead of balsa today, but
yeah.
Most likely.
I guess start with supports at each of the points.
Are you talking Sasha through it?
I don't know.
We're talking
asked,
you through
me,
it.
He asked me when we start.
Yeah, so go ahead.
So we need supports, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Where do we place the supports?
At the edges, at the points of the left line.
Yeah.
Hey Aaron, what would you do? You don't know? Okay.
So you will place supports at the end of the bridge.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. Go ahead.
You're with it? Okay.
Yeah, of course.
So the key, one of the key things is you need to identify points to put supports. So in this case, there's actually four supports in this bridge, right? How do you get those points? Like they exist in the model, but you need to extract them to identify where the supports are.
Use the list.
Huh?
Use the list.
Yeah, you could, like, is it a list item?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you could list item the two dispatched lines.
Yeah, somewhere. So if you go back into the support ones, you can list them. Less than your vertices.
There's obviously, like, if you make your model in an efficient way, so you already have this idea of where the supports are, you can make sure that they're defined early on, so you don't have to sort of like search through. Unfortunately, I've just mushed everything into one list and exploited it all, so now Branko has to find it.
Which is actually a good task, because sometimes...
You have to do that.
Exactly.
So, Branko, one way of finding the index without having to go through and search is if you go up to the display, it'll be the first D in that list, and it'll be... see those numbers on the right in vector? So if you grab... Yep. So just make sure that your exploded list is flattened. Yep. And then hide the points, so as in not that component, but actually, oh yeah, or you can make the size.
And then
I would probably make it 10. So you can see there, one of the support points is 0. And 6, because they're like stacked on each other, right? It's going to be the same structure, because it's just been moved.
Oh, you just moved it? Yeah.
Yeah. So, our supports
Where do we think the supports will be?
At the ends.
So, what index?
So, 0 and
40. And what would the other one be?
What is that, 15?
I reckon that's 16.
16?
Yeah.
Things like that?
Yeah, sure. That's one way of doing it. Yeah, no, it's like... you probably don't have to copy the panel.
Just
I don't think... I don't think that will work. Because just remember, what have you done to the list? Yeah, so what have you done to the original list to get those points?
No, no.
So you need to copy the list item.
Okay.
Paste it, yep. And now what the top explode needs to go into the
top one.
Yeah. And the bottom explode needs to go on, or you could flip them around if you want.
My bottom?
Yeah. So the bottom explode needs to go on the bottom one.
Bottom one.
See the bottom explode? Needs
okay.
to go into the bottom list item.
Okay.
Yeah? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, so now if you hide everything but those points, like, yeah. You should be getting the end supports.
Yep.
Yep. Now, do you remember what you did to fit them onto the table? Like, how did you stop them from... Was there anything stopping them from moving?
Tape, yeah.
What was stopping them? The tape?
Tape, yeah.
So how would you describe tape in this circumstance?
As a moment?
Yep. So how would you describe a moment support?
It's quite Karamba
time. Well, what is the tape restraining in terms of those 6 degrees of freedom?
What's that?
Why have you copied it?
You can copy it because for a real bridge.
Yeah.
One of the
one can be
needs to be rolled out.
Yeah.
So you take one of it. And the other one will be the roller in X direction.
So in analysing this, if it came out that, say we had two moment supports but we had a roller on one side, should we have like the two separate ones to begin with so that we can change it as we go?
Ideally, it would be the best if every single point that is a support can be addressed separately,
its
own support design. Because sometimes, particularly for bridges, if you just look on the top view, that's the center line of the bridge. What you have is most likely two supports here, obviously, and two supports here. And because of, first of all, the length of your system, you have thermal expansion to deal with. So that means that somewhere you can't restrain everything, otherwise it will just be exploded and crack everywhere. So you need to release some of the forces in your system. And that means that you're having most likely in one end of the bridge, the roller, so that the bridge can move back and forward, even though it's just minimal, like, you know, a centimeter maximum, probably maybe the best. And then also for, depending on what kind of bridge and the location of the bridge, if it's windy or any other impact on it, sometimes you also want to have a support that moves also sideways to cope again with some of the restraint forces and to allow a little bit of flexibility in the system. So therefore, ideally you have a scenario of a bridge or any structural system where you can control each support separately in terms of your initial design. So now we've got our supports, what do we need next in terms of translating it into a Karamba model?
Horizontal members.
First we need to establish that all the slides become structural members.
Okay.
Yeah. So we just say lines V. All lines that we got here in our system. They would cover our lines. And then we just need to load it or flatten everything. And then all those lines are now sort of recognized as a structural element.
Are you guys following? Does it make sense?
Yeah.
Do you remember with kangaroo how you used the lines and we applied the spring force to those lines? And those lines then became springs in kangaroo? Do you remember that? This is just the same, So you're instructing Karamba that this is a beam, and then Karamba understands them as beams.
And now, obviously, we have the simplest scenario, but without any physical property attached to it other than our points that are fixed. What else do we need? We need loads. So, Karamba again. Go to loads. And then we can have.
We need a point in the center. With this doorway. Do we want to.
Just do a point light at the moment.
Okay. I guess there is a linear load there.
But we'll just stick with point for now.
Where do you want to apply the point? Only in the middle.
I don't know, what do you think? Should we do it like we did?
What do you want to do?
A line load across all of the. I guess we have some sort of thing.
But if you apply a line load, that means that you have.
Yeah, I mean, we'll go across the top.
Yeah, no, but if you, the idea of a line load is that you have a constant load across the top.
So
when does that happen in the bridge?
So at the points, the vertices of the algebra.
So where do you walk on your design of the bridge?
On the points, the vertices.
Yeah, but do you walk at the edge? So ideally, we would have a point also assigned in the middle of the bridge, obviously. So those are things that you can really try to simulate as precise as possible. In that case, we just apply a point somewhere in the system. Again, if we only want to have it at the top, it's most likely that we take all the vertices. Start to sort the points.
You can, if you go back, if you go to the dispatches prior to this, so that on the left,
yeah.
If you get the dispatch points from B, see the points that make up that line.
Yeah.
So that the points that have been coming out of dispatch and the points that come out of the move,
yeah.
They should be all the points on the top. Not that one. Yeah, that one. And then they've been moved in the y direction.
So those are the points. What we can do now is really analyze a moving object, for instance.
Mm-hmm. Did you want 2 points?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the force, it will be a force in this direction.
So guys, can anyone remember how much weight a person, how much force a person would apply to a bridge?
Newtons.
So we'll just say like 1 kilonewton, roughly.
sure,
why not? Just to make it simple. So, this Karamba works in kilonewtons, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, newtons is for a structure way too small as a unit.
Like a balsa wood structure.
Yeah. Sort of.
Obviously,
everything should be negative, so it's really one kilonewton is more in the Z direction.
So do we have all the ingredients we need to start analyzing now? So, guys, do you remember when John was doing the lectures and every time he was sort of showing a rigid body diagram, what did he always have? He had lines to describe beams, he had supports, he'd always draw in those supports, remember? And then he'd always show you a force being applied to that structure. And that's exactly what is being set up here. So the top one are the lines that are the beams, that second middle section are the supports, and then the bottom is the force being applied. Yeah?
Yep.
So now we have all the ingredients. We can pretty much collect all of the information and bring it in our heart of Karamba, which is then the assembly model, where we collect all the information. So all the lines or elements go into our structural elements. Our supports go into the support. Our loads go into loads. Since this is a pre-setup, we only work now with one cross-section that comes inbuilt in also materials or steel, and we have a tubular hollow cross-section. And to visualize this, we can have a look at the model again. So this is the structural setup.
It doesn't look like you've got the horizontals.
Yeah.
It's that curve parameter on the left.
So we got our elements, and we have one applied load, and the load. And the load can jump, travel across on one side of the bridge. So this sort of is a cross check just for us to see if that model, you know, is sort of correct in terms of what we want. And we can also already have a look at our structure. So we see here that at one end, all of our supports, we can scale the graphics up so it's easier to identify. So we see that here, all of those, they are restrained in all directions and also around their rotation, and here at the end, they also all restrained.
And so, those two items, that's going to give you the start and end.
Yeah, no, that might be two of those.
So it's because you wanted to put rollers on the end of one of them?
Yeah.
So you need to probably graph them and then put them into a flip matrix.
Yeah, otherwise those two will have.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
So here now the bridge can, these two supports can now move in this direction.
It's the, so you're doing the two supports on one side can move
yep.
that way. Okay, cool.
Why not?
Okay.
And this is pretty much everything we need, and then we can already start to analyze. And as long as this tool is great, obviously everything is correct. If it's similar to everything else in Grasshopper, if it's orange, something is missing. If it's red, something went terribly wrong, and we have to start from scratch. So, and then to visualize this again now, when there's nothing much happening. And this is due to different things. And one is, if you look at the beams,
set it to meters. If you
what was your input in terms?
I put in 600 mils to represent
the width is 600.
No, the length was 600 because that's
the length was 600.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You put
I put 600.
So
that's now 6 meters.
In meters.
And then
what was the width?
I made it 50, and I made the height 50. That's the height. It's too wide. It's that Y value there, and you could duplicate it. It's being duplicated.
Yeah. So here, in terms of the deformation, we have now 4 centimeters, 4.5 centimeters of deformation, which is not a lot. And we can try to.
Is it if you move the point into the middle, will it deform more?
Yeah, definitely.
It almost feels like it's reading it as meters instead of millimeters.
Do
setting it to original?
Pardon? It defaults to like a CHS.
Defaults,
yeah. You were just next to it. This is it on the left. Keep going. Looks like an N. There we go.
So that's what I meant with sometimes it's a bit buggy in terms of units. Best is really to work in the units. And here, because everything is a rigid connection in the system, we have now really not a lot of deformation, even though the load is eccentric, but we now sort of can increase the load. And there is, we see that there is some deformation. And there, obviously, the deformation also gets higher, and then we can again visualize it. So wherever we have our load, it's the highest. And here in the displacement, we then can see what elements in terms of the thrust are under tension and are under compression, and if that is a proper setup, and the joints can be then manipulated so that we have only a hinge system in the middle, and where we have the compression elements similar to rear thrust, we have then a rigid connection. And then
did that make sense? Yeah? So there's you've got your centerline model, that's effectively the thing that's gonna be analyzed, and from it you need to have this, you can extract points for supports, and you can extract lines for beams. And then from that, you can apply forces as point loads to that. So that's really like the first part of the script is effectively drawing the bridge. Then there's a section, like if we scroll to the right, that section with the items, so the list items, that's effectively extracting the points for supports and point loads. The explode, which is just left of that screen, is just making sure all of our polylines are single line elements, because if you put polylines in this, it won't work. And so they then feed into the line to beams, supports, and point loads. And then, as Sasha said before, the heart of Karamba, it's really, if you don't have this particular component, you're not really doing anything. The assemble component,
yep,
which is that big sort of this one right here, yeah, and then that needs to be analyzed. Now that particular display component, the displace, the model view, that doesn't necessarily need to be there, right?
No, it's just really for checking.
It's just for checking.
We can also just ignore that.
So that then goes into the analysis. Now the analysis is giving us an idea of displacement, but then we can also see the deformation and all the various like utilization through model view and beam view.
Yeah.
And beam view can also be plugged into analyze, or does it need to go through model view?
No, you can straight plug it in there as well.
Cool. So basically, whenever something says model, you can plug any model into that.
Yeah.
So we can get a beam view without analyzing.
You get the beam view without analyzing, or you get the beam view with analyzing.
Yeah. Cool. Is that making sense? Yeah. Cool. So if we were to, like, it's 4:30. We should be finishing up around 5 o'clock today. Does anyone have any questions about really what we've just covered today in terms of super basics? Like this is just like, this should be enough for you guys to go away and do analysis on your bridges now. Because there's not it, like, the apart from like maybe putting in the statistics of what balsa is, that's fine. Like you could make your bridges out of steel and still analyze like how they would work
in general
relative to the system. But you should be able to go away and do that, right? As long as you're using like center lines. Yeah? Okay.
Can you show them how to touch on the center, right? So instead of having rigid joints,
Isn't that the hinges?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not in this version.
No, but okay. The modified beam is not there in.
The modified beam is in there, but I'm not sure if it's in the free version.
The modify element.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have.
So take into account type of joints in the process of the program.
Yeah, they're rigid at the moment.
Joints, but there's a way to put, instead
yes.
of rigid, articulated, so you are not going to have moments in the body.
Yeah.
So like pin joints or something.
Yeah.
So therefore you need to modify the elements. And this is the easiest way to do. So before you assemble anything, and you pick then certain elements in your system. And therefore sometimes the model view here is also quite handy. So you can see all the numbers of each of the elements in the system. And here, obviously, we see that 23, 21, 18, and 16, they all have tension. So therefore, they can act as a bending active element. And you can select then those elements. So you go into here. You select on all the beams that you want. So it's basically in there. Go to panels. So those are the elements that you want to modify. And here you can see that there's a little option called bending. And if the bending, if the element has a bending stiffness, or if it has no bending stiffness. And for truss elements, there are no bending stiffness involved. So if you just say those elements have no bending stiffness at all, they become like truss elements. And then you can just put that in here. And there you see then those orange circles around the elements, and these are the hinges. And there we already have an instant change in our graphics and our utilization and how they really work. So this is the easiest way how to manipulate your elements.
So they're being put under less stress now.
Yeah.
Yep. So those of you who remember Branko's group's model, that it was all rigid elements, right? Even though he had made a truss, he had made those elements rigid. So that clearly shows that if he had gone through and met the group, had gone through and made those particular zones around the where the point load and made them pin joints instead of rigid, it could have actually withstood more weight. Yeah? Okay. Yes.
So for each load we need its own load note.
Yes.
So we can't, because the cans are like, they're uniform, right? So
yep, but there was a certain area that they were being applied, right?
Right.
So you could generalize and take the weight and just spread them out over that zone and then push down on those nodes.
So we could set the load to be across the air.
Yes, but what you would do, so for example, if you've got 1 kilonewton pushing down, you would divide that over 5 nodes, 10 nodes.
Okay, so we'd like to say...
It's not super realistic, but in terms of like real life bridges, but in terms of what we were doing within that exercise, yeah, it's like a pressure being pushed down. So Sasha mentioned before, point load, you can actually hack point load to do all the different types of loads. So like a line load or a pressure. So if you just grab all those points on the top and just put a uniform load down upon them, it's similar to having a pressure, but you're applying them in a way, like, we didn't go along and, like, if this was your beam, thank you, if this was your beam, we didn't put a can on, like, a timber wedge and, like, have it sit directly in the middle of a beam, right?
Yeah.
It was kind of spread out across the whole thing. So all you have to do is just make sure that as long as that's on a node, then it's relatively representative of what was happening. Yeah? Cool.
Yeah, so structural analysis is really about simplifying everything what you do. And every time you have surface areas or volumes, you can just still break it down into lines and points.
Yeah.
If you take all the bars and make it like without bending, in the points that you have the support,
yep,
you will have a problem there
because they're not fixed and they're just
and the support.
Yep.
So how could we solve it? Because if I want to have a hinge in the endpoints of each bar, how can I do to like avoid this problem with the support?
Say it again.
The support has, so each support has freedom of movement in axes as well.
Yeah, I know. Look, the thing is that when you select all the bars and
yeah,
you tell the program,
hinge,
all the bars are without
hinge
bending.
Yeah.
So they put a hinge in each node.
Yeah,
but
they don't
put
on the support.
In the supports as well.
They
so
also put a hinge on the support.
Yeah, I think so. Isn't it?
Yeah, but as long as you have a support at the same position where you have a hinge, then they sort of,
it can counteract.
Exactly.
So it is solved, like we don't need to do anything else.
No, just place a support there where you want to fix it.
So supports overrule hinges.
Okay. I just try and it doesn't work. So it didn't work. I'm going to try again. Maybe it's because they're of the person.
Any other questions? No? So we've got class tomorrow from 9 till 1. So Sash will be here during that time, and then you'll never see him again. Okay? So what would be really good is if you guys... I actually like this setup where there's like a break, a large break in between. If you guys understand what you need to do for your next assignment, right? In terms of analyzing all of those models that you've made, and also analyzing the pavilion and making an improved model of the bridge. If you've got any questions to do with Karamba, then Sash is far better at answering those questions than me. So you've got tomorrow morning to ask those questions. So we're going to cover a few more sort of like slightly more advanced topics tomorrow, and then we'll also cover the questions. And then tomorrow afternoon, Christina and I will continue and we'll work more so in a tutorial environment, working on your assignments with Karamba, with us around, right? So there's kind of like a safety net for another 4 hours for you guys, and then you guys go on break, right? Yeah?
Woo!
Yay, woo, break. Assignments due after it though, right? Cool? So, any questions at all? We've got 15 minutes.
I wanted to ask you why it didn't work so well.
The scale?
Yeah, is that because of reading in millimeters or...?
Yeah, it's really about how you input, obviously, a system. If you work in millimeters, then you have to make sure that you're not typing in 60, the number or the value, because you're thinking that bridge is 60 meters, and then suddenly it's 6,000. And then sometimes those numbers in Rhino overrule what Karamba really needs, and then they apply forces, and also the sizes of the cross sections, they don't really match up with what you draw, and therefore, that's a bit of a bug. Therefore, you just work in meters if you're in a line. Problem solved.
Well, the good thing with working in meters is then, like units like pascals, you don't have to do any conversion to get that.
For the purpose of this assignment, can we just work in meters?
Yeah, go ahead.
And what you also can do, and that works as well, if you don't want to switch to meters in Rhino, just use a scale in Grasshopper, scale everything up to meters, and then do the analysis. That's also possible.
Sorry.
So that's now all hinges.
Okay, yeah.
Can you have this?
Sure.
Everyone can have it.
I'm not sure they
will.
Well,
yeah, you know, I'm going to put it on the website.
Oh, you'll put it on?
Yeah.
Oh,
I'll
just go
do
it.
Huh?
I'll grab it there.
Sure.
When is this specific unit? This
not next Friday, or not?
It was a short holiday. So in the holidays.
It's due on a weekday. Oh, on a week.
If you have a...
It's a week. Where's the...
Also,
do we have another
class?
Is
that
8 or 9?
Yeah. Let me refer to the course outline.
8 or 9 what? Isn't that a
week? If it's due 8 or 9, then no.
It's
the
week.
It's the week.
The week.
That's with April.
So you've got a week with us, you've got a week.
Force is meant to be negative.
It is.
But I'm a bit terrible with this.
Who's
the biggest?
Yeah, you got a week. Yeah. Yeah, you got a week. It's due on. Yeah, it's due on the Friday.
First Friday back.
Do you want me to make it due on the Sunday?
No, I reckon just a week.
Well, do we have
to
list
you
on the
last
one?
Yeah, this is checking.
We'll make it during
the
Sunday. So you
can check
your
time.
Of course. The guys, that pavilion
free
design, the pavilion design needs to be analyzed. Okay? So we want to see some logic being put into that other than just like.
And
yeah,
a different thing. Once every time
then
we lose,
yeah,
you sound
it. What up? There are some really clever things that we can do with Karamba. So, I think we need to do that.
Okay.
But yeah, we can do it for our afternoon.
So, wait, because I know you said before that you're killing the whole person, we're not putting on the straight to the
yeah, so the thing about structures is you can use it, you can just go in and put a whole bunch of weight on and start seeing where all the stresses are. So even though it might not be like a 10 time, at least use what the results are to improve the structure.
Right, yeah, so this is like more obvious to see.
Yeah, so the falsehood model is not so good at doing analysis because it's just like that new to the false group right here. Versus like really certainly start with original ways. So just one moment. Sasha. If you've got a structure that isn't actually receiving any point loads, such as a pavilion, does Karamba take into account the weight of the material that you're using?
Yeah, that's already coming over.
Yeah. So for example, when you're designing the pavilion, no one's going to be walking around on the roof, right? So it's likely that you're not going to be putting any point loads on the top. But what's stopping from someone from coming along and doing this, right? Like leaning on it or wind getting pushed upon it. So those types of things are going to be dynamic loads that are applied, and you need to be considering those in the design.
Maybe red is like, I don't know, this is with what is name?
John?
Yeah.
Second order forces.
Yeah, but so like, let me look at it in Karamba, let me look at it.
It's a force, instead of a force pointing down, it's a force pointing left, and you just apply it to every noun. I'll point you to where some areas you can get those types of numbers.
That's
why I want to know.
That's
why I want to know. Okay, so
Thank you.